Welcome back to One Hit Wonderland, where we take a look at bands and artists known for only one song, or one dance in this case. Do the hustle! The Hustle is not the first disco song. There's debate on what the first disco song is. Maybe it's this song, or this one, or this one. One hit wonders all. But all of those songs are from 1974, so they'd all predate The Hustle, which hit number one in July of 75. But The Hustle still feels like the first of something, some kind of milestone or tipping point. I wasn't there, obviously, but that's the way it looks to me. It's the first number one single that could not be conceivably defined as anything else. A lot of those early disco hits, if you ask people, I think they'd probably still say it's just soul music or funk or something. But The Hustle is not. It's not soul, it's not funk, it's not R&B, it's just disco. It was intended for one place, the dance floor. And for that reason, I suspect The Hustle is when disco became the phenomenon we know it as now. The unignorable force that would end up defining and dominating the rest of the 70s. And you could thank one guy for that, Van the Man. Van McCoy, I should say, that's his name. A man who had spent his entire career working for other people, waiting for his moment to shine. And he did it with one of the greatest grooves in dance history. And look, I have no idea how to do The Hustle. I'm not sure I would even recognize The Hustle if I saw other people doing it, but I love The Hustle regardless. And so did most of America, because it was not just a popular song from a super popular genre. It was a craze just on its own. In fact, Hustle Mania predates the song itself. It was humongous, and the man behind it almost doesn't matter. Like, I realize this show is about one-hit wonders, but The Hustle really, thoroughly dwarfs its own artist more than anything I've ever covered here. Which is saying a lot, because this guy turned out to have a pretty fascinating career. So let's check it out. Possibly while doing a quarter step backwards and putting our finger in the air. Van McCoy from Washington, D.C. was one of those music industry lifers who's always working behind the scenes and usually never gets that big break of their own. Like, I think his success, both behind the scenes and eventually under his own name, happened just through sheer volume. Like, if you write 1,000 songs, one of them's gotta be a hit. And I'm only barely exaggerating. Like, the amount of credits this guy has to his name is insane. So I'm just going to try and pick out the highlights of his songwriting career. Baby, I'm yours. Oh man, absolute chestnut right there. R&B classic from the mid-60s, covered about a billion times. Giving up. One of Gladys Knight's first hits, also covered many times. That is David Ruffin from The Temptations. All his biggest solo hits were from Van McCoy. This one hit the top 10. All good stuff. He also did some orchestra work. He did all the string arrangements for the Stylistics' biggest hits. I want to point out this one he did specifically, Love is the Answer, because he did an instrumental version of that one on his own. Do, 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 do. Yeah, that's just The Hustle in a minor key. Yeah, you will hear bits of The Hustle here and there and everywhere in all his songs. So apparently he found his true calling as a songwriter and arranger, including his big hit, of course, which is an instrumental. But he did originally want to be a singer. His first release songs were from his teenage doo-wop group in the late 50s, and he was releasing singles all through the 60s that just never caught on. He even got to release a whole vocal album in 1966. Here it is, Nighttime is Lonely Time, produced by the legendary Mitch Miller. Wait, Mitch, isn't that the sing-along orchestra guy from like old black and white TV? This is the guy you want to make your pop album? Nighttime is lonely time. The sun goes down. Okay, to be clear, this is what soul music sounded like in 1966. So yeah, I mean, I guess there's always room in music for throwbacks, but you know, I don't think you can be surprised he didn't take off trying to be Nat King Cole in a James Brown world. But the guy always said that his main influences were classical composers as much as modern music, so naturally he started leaning towards making instrumental work. He formed his new band, the Soul City Symphony, and he started pumping his energy into that in the mid-70s. And at the same time, there was this new energy springing up out of these dance scenes. And he saw one new dance, he decided to make a song for it, and he shat something out in an hour. And naturally, it was his biggest hit. Disco is well before my time. It was already ancient history by the time I was born. But in the course of my life, I've seen that history get drastically rewritten. I was first made aware of disco as the worst music ever made. And then, like, overnight, it became the greatest music ever made. And I kind of think it's getting beaten into the ground. It's been weird to watch disco turn into yet another over-mythologized genre like punk rock and grunge and gangster rap. Honestly, I'm a little tired of it. But I do get why people talk it up so much. A big part of it is critics and historians re-examining the undercurrents of racism and homophobia and the backlash, and you know, that's all pretty well covered. But there's another reason for the turnaround on disco that needs to be mentioned. These songs hold the fuck up. Well, not all of them hold up. There are, in fact, a ton of shitty disco songs out there, but a whole lot of them have aged really well, including The Hustle, which is fucking killer. Like, I don't dance at all, but even I know this is a great song. The weird thing is that people were doing The Hustle before they had The Hustle to hustle to. According to what I can find, the dance had already existed for years. Puerto Rican kids were doing it in the Bronx because the chaperones didn't like them grinding on each other, so they invented this dance, and it just kind of spread out from there. Like, this is the dance that made disco.
The Hustle, I think, was the biggest disco dance of that whole era. It just had this infectious beat to it that made you want to do The Hustle.
And there wound up being just an insane number of Hustle songs. I'm not even sure Van McCoy was the first, but it's definitely my favorite. Like, this is the one that deserves to be called just The Hustle. It's like one of my favorite disco songs ever. Granted, I decided that a week ago while writing this episode. I can't believe I didn't realize how much I like this song. Like, it starts off with that beautiful, like, almost angelic intro, and it promises you, like, spiritual enlightenment or something. God is a DJ, and he is ready to boogie. And then you get one of the two actual lyrics in the song. I'll be honest, that actually kind of strikes me as a little creepy. Get the gun! But then once the Son of Sam voices go away, the funk guitar starts building up, and the strings get higher, and then we get those magic words. Do the hustle. Do the hustle. Do the hustle. When some songs tell you to dance, it is a command. But The Hustle is not really making any demands, they're just confident you're gonna do it. And they were correct. But of course the hook of the song is not those three words. There are a lot of instruments on The Hustle, and they all get their moment. But The Hustle is driven by one specifically. That flute solo. The song's success rides on it. It is such a perfect hook, so memorable. Let's face it, so annoying. It is just unignorable. It feels fitting that The Hustle, arguably the first disco hit, has an instrumental line so incessantly catchy, it can only be matched by the last disco hit, Funky Town. If someone wants to mash up the flute from The Hustle with the beeping synth line from Funky Town, I'm certain you could melt brains with it. It would destroy people. And then we get that beautiful trumpet solo, which, okay, it does sound a bit like the Price is Right theme, yes. Van McCoy, come on down! And you can tell this came pretty early in the disco era, because the later disco songs have a lot more bass in it, you know, and the drums hit a lot harder. Yeah, there's not a lot of the disco thump thump in The Hustle. It's all treble. Violins, flute, trumpet. It's all still very lush and orchestrated. Like, Philly Soul was still kind of big at the time, so that feels like a much bigger influence on The Hustle than anything else. It's more similar to, like, the OJs or to Barry White, who had his own orchestra that sounded something similar to this. In fact, they sound nearly identical, because The Hustle is basically Barry White's Can't Get Enough of Your Love, Babe, with flute instead of Barry. My darling, I can't get enough of your love, babe. Now let's all do The Hustle! Do The Hustle! I don't actually know how to do The Hustle. In fact, I'm not entirely clear what The Hustle is. Apparently there are a whole lot of different dances with that name. There's the ballroom couple dance, and that one seems like it takes a lot of work and you need lessons for it. But then there's also the line dance hustle, which looks a lot easier. And there's like the Latin hustle, the Spanish hustle, the New York hustle, the California hustle. I don't even know if these are different dances or they're just different names. I looked up a lot of tutorials and they all told me something different.
Forward, back, quack, quack, hustle, 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 tap, tap, tap.
Yeah, honestly, I think I maybe know less about how to hustle than when I started. But even so, there's something magical about this song. Just the big sweeping strings and the beautiful trumpet. Like, this song to me is just like a beautiful sunny day or a great view. It just puts a big smile on my face. Obviously, Van McCoy went away after this. Dance crazes are not a good way to build up a career. Ask Salento, or Mr. C the Slide Man, or Los Del Rio, or Little Eva, or so on. Because people care more about the dance than the music, so if anyone should launch to stardom, it's the choreographer. But this guy was obviously extremely talented, so he did more than you'd guess. So let's check that out. The follow-up to The Hustle has actual words to it. It's called Change with the Times, from the album The Disco Kid. Awesome vest, man. And you know, Change with the Times, that's a good title for a guy who led the world into the bold, new, defining sound of the 70s. Maybe it's something he learned from his weird, out-of-date debut. If he'd known to change with the times in 1966, he could have broken through a lot earlier. So the title fits, but honestly, this song didn't do much for me. Not much of a hook to it, and I'd skip it entirely if not for this hilarious video that goes with it. I like that he has to conduct, seeing as he's not a singer, but we don't see who he's conducting, so he's just staring at you awkwardly. And you can see him, like, singing too, but I don't know if that's actually him singing. The vocal group in his orchestra is Faith, Hope, and Charity, which was another of the bands he produced. I don't know which one the guy is. Maybe he's Charity. I don't know, maybe Van's singing also? I couldn't tell you. And I guess that big pile of riches in the foreground is the money he made by changing with the times and getting into disco. Oh, also, Van McCoy is a giant. Cool. Dude, what are you looking at? What? Anyway, this did make a little dent in the R&B charts, but didn't break the pop top 40. Probably because there's no dance that goes with it. He had another song, Party, and that one's a little funkier. It landed at number 20 on the R&B charts, and, well, honestly, that's about as good as it gets as far as success in America goes. Like, the fact that he mostly made instrumentals might have been a difficult sell. Dance music has always been better for instrumentals than most genres, but not that much better. People like to sing along. However, he did land one last big top 10 hit, albeit in the UK. And really, that has to be considered his real follow-up. So here it is. The spiritual successor to The Hustle, The Shuffle. It's basically just The Hustle in 6/8 time. And I don't like it nearly as much. But I am impressed that the Brits of 77 could dance to music that wasn't in 4/4. I mean, disco music is not supposed to be that complicated. Donch, 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 donch. Simple and easy so you don't lose your place. 6/8 is not exactly super complicated. I mean, it's simple enough, but this is music for the masses. Anything harder than the basics is gonna throw them off. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, So congrats to the Brits and their superior music education that they were able to groove to The Shuffle. Van McCoy pumped out a lot of albums in the last half of the 70s. Only a couple of them are available on Spotify, but I checked out what was there. I wanted to mention this one I liked, African Symphony. This is not Van's version, obviously. This is a newer version, because this one's apparently still very popular with orchestras today. I think maybe based on that, he was inspired to make Rhythms of the World, a disco instrumental album including eclectic music styles from all over the globe. Here is the Soul Cha-Cha. Nice. And here is Oriental Boogie. Okay, that one feels a little outdated. And here is Indian Warpath. Okay, I think we're kind of losing the plot here. Anyway, towards the end of the 70s, he was getting tired of disco, and he was talking about transitioning into other genres. But sadly, he would not get that chance because he would not live to see the 80s. He died of a heart attack in 1979 at the way too young age of 39. Since it was the disco era, kind of easy to assume what caused the heart attack. It would also explain how insanely productive he was. But I've seen some places say he was just in bad health in general. We can only speculate. And it's a shame, because a guy like that, as talented an orchestrator and composer as he was, he would have been working in music for the next few decades, I'm sure. The man was extremely talented, so does he deserve more credit for all the things he did? Yeah, absolutely. Do I think he deserves to be a household name or have any of his other songs be big hits? No, not really. No, I think The Hustle was the best thing he ever put his name on, and if that's his legacy, it's a pretty nice one to go out on. Really, he was like the first of the modern dance producers, right? He's the one who realized he didn't have to give credit to any of his songs to anyone else. He could just put his name on his own work. So Calvin Harris, David Guetta, they owe him a debt of gratitude. Yeah, this song still rules. Here, I'm gonna see if I can dance in this chair. Travolta, Travolta. Quack, quack, snap, snap. Hustle, hustle, hustle.